Today we are programming Lorna Shores to the Hellfire completely with MIDI instruments. What's up? My name is Maxime. I'm the founder of Solemn Tones, and for years we have been creating the software that your favorite bands and producers use to write and produce their music. Behind me I have the session of a Lorna Shore to the Hellfire cover where the whole song was covered. So the orchestra, the drums, the bass, guitars, the vocals, basically everything from scratch. And it's all fully MIDI except for the vocals, of course. This is what it sounds like. So right now we can dive into the session and I'll show you some of the tricks I use to really get the maximum result out of MIDI instruments. So we're right here in the session, and let me first give you a quick tour. So the first track here is the acoustic intro. As you know, Lorna Shores to the Hellfire starts with this very gentle acoustic. And funnily enough, I do not actually own like an acoustic sampler that is not the Logic stock. And that's because I think the Logic stock acoustic is actually pretty impressive. Obviously, like, it's not a real acoustic guitar, but it's pretty damn close. And so if you use some of the techniques you see here, and we'll go through that later, this thing sounds pretty good, you know? Then next, we have the rhythm guitars right here. As you can see, they start instantly here. So we have Odin on the left and we have Odin on the right. If you want to see what that looks like, basically we have guitar 2 on the right loaded, and then we have guitar 1 on the left loaded. This way we can have the amp sims, you know, on both sides. After that, some EQ and so forth. Then we have for the leads, which is this section. That is panned leads essential. So rather than having 100% panned Odins, we now have 50% panned Odins or something like that. Maybe 30, I don't really remember. After that, we have the Odin solo. So if we go to the very end of the song right here, the solo is quite the interesting MIDI. I think we're gonna have a lot of fun with this one. As you can see, a lot of little tricks going on here to really sell that. But I think the result is very, very impressive. And once again, right here, we have guitar 1 for Odin loaded. Next, we have Odin solo 2, which once again is guitar 1. And this is gonna play that harmony. The reason that I got away with loading guitar 1 instead of guitar 2 here is because there's no real overlap for the notes, as far as I'm aware. If there were overlap, you would want to load guitar 2 here, so there's no phasing. After that, we have Loki right here. Again, we'll dive into that very, very soon. Then we have Mjolnir drums, which is the biggest sounding drums you've ever heard. We have the vocals, which is just one big vocal bus. This is just the flattened stack, basically. In terms of processing, I baked Beast into it. As you saw on the vocal editing tutorial, we had Beast on Beast mode for the lows, and we had Beast on Serpent mode for the mids and highs. Then we have the church choir, also stock from Logic. Really nothing special to be said about that. Now next, for the chorus, we have this stack of strings and brass, because as you know, Lorna Shore has these massive orchestrals. Honestly, I don't even know if that's the exact correct melody, because these are so tucked under the mix in the original, but it got close enough and it worked, so whatever. Then we have this orchestral burr, is what I call it. It's basically a big stack of orchestrals that I put really low into the mix, together with some synths and so forth, basically to thicken up the post-chorus, because at post-chorus, you actually have extremely high guitars, but the brass and string section vanishes, so you suddenly have like this emptiness inside your mix. So I just generated a synth brass type of deal, you'll see.
Yeah.
As you can see, that is a weird sound. It is very low into the mix. It is brass, it is strings, and then of course 80% of the sound is just a big synth. Next, for effects, of course, all the big whooshes, risers, reverse cymbals, and so forth. This is Bifrost 2, recently released, by the way. So if you're interested in more interesting effects being added into your productions, Bifrost 2, I cannot recommend it enough. These just sound so huge and insane. Yeah, that is like a big impact. And so we basically have a bunch of those risers and so forth all throughout the song. I think there's one reverse cymbal from Bifrost 1 inside this effect stack, but beyond that, it's mostly Bifrost 2. And then finally, we have our Solemn Tones one shots, basically reinforcing Mjolnir drums further. So if I solo that right here, let's check out a bigger drum fill right here. But so that is the session really quickly as an overview. Let's now go into detail. So let's start with the rhythm guitars, Odin right here. As you can see, kind of like with the Slaughter to Prevail track we did the other day, nothing really special is going on. We just start with this big chord and everything at high velocity. And it just sounds big. And then we have some more chords like that. We did have to carve some more space than usual, making these a little thinner, because the lead is also playing at the same time and it otherwise gets quite busy. You probably also hear that in the original To the Hellfire mix, where you have a lot going on at the same time because it's quite a complex song. And as you can see right here, I added this quick like dun-chuk, because I believe I also heard that in the original song. So right here. Once again, the most important thing to realize here is that you should be connecting all your nodes. Don't leave any empty space whatsoever in your programming, unless you're going for like ridiculous machine gunning, of course. After that, once again, just quick blasting, blasting, blasting. It's just busy, busy, busy. Then later on, we have these palm mutes right here. Kind of very similar to the Slaughter to Prevail track we actually did here. You can check this out. Of course, this sounds way better when you actually back it up with the huge drums and the bass as well. So all at low velocities. In this case, it's velocity 29. Just try to stay under 32 for palm mutes. Then we have that very busy pre-chorus, of course. And then we get the chorus. Now, interestingly, in the chorus, this main rhythm guitar is mostly playing like a lead. And then instead of having proper low chords, rhythm guitar type of deal, we actually just have orchestra. The orchestra, this right here, is basically filling up the low mids that the guitar normally would. And then by trying to blend it in the mix and so forth, also of course hitting this fat riser to kind of make that transition not awkward, as you can see right here, you don't really notice that there's no real rhythm guitar as usual. It's just this high chingling. And then after the chorus, we go into this after chorus. I'm not sure what to call it, but as you can see, the strings no longer play this low thing. They actually go into a very high melody. So now we would actually miss that rhythm guitar, which is why I added this. I'm not sure if it was a thing in the original, but that's how I try to fix the issue. So So then we keep going. Nothing too special going on here. Again, you just have your palm mutes between those higher notes. This is like very typically metalcore, deathcore style. Then we have more aggressive tremolo picking to then go into these blast beats. Or, well, you know, you have the blast beats on the kick, and then you have an attempt at blasting on the guitars. And of course, the bass then also tries to play the same thing right here, but just without chords. You know, chords on very low bass is usually gonna clash a lot with the guitar, so we don't try to do that. So keeping the bass simple, just jamming the root note at the exact same time as the guitar and not palm muting. That can kind of blow out your low end. Just a regular alternative picking will do here. Just machine gunning right here. Then after that, we go back into the same piece from before. And then the chorus. As you hear, this mix is actually different from the one that we ended up releasing, because the actual mix was made by Lucas at Core Studio. This is more of like a demo mix just to produce and write a MIDI with, but then nothing was changed about the MIDI later on. So the only difference is really the mix. After that, we go into the bridge, which also contains a solo. And I think that is actually the most interesting part about the guitar programming here, because as you can see, it's just all pretty simple stuff. It's palm mutes, it's regular alternative picking. There's virtually no other key switches, I believe, if I check. Yeah. I didn't use a single key switch on any of these rhythm guitars because it just wasn't necessary. It was all very aggressive, in the face, metal, and usually Odin just nails that without any humanization. But then of course, if we head into the solo right here in the bridge, this is where we did have to do some work. We put the first part of the solo in the back with a lo-fi effect on it, because that's also how the final mix was and in the original. So as you can see right here, we did have to do some humanization compared to the rhythm guitars, where we didn't have to do anything really. So what kind of techniques did we use here? If you've watched the programming solos with Mystic video, we're basically doing the exact same tricks we used there here, but I'll quickly go over it again. Right here, when you have this note going legato into the next one, even if it's not a slide, it is wise to add some of those transition notes, because your left hand is never going to be so perfect that you go from playing one note and then going perfectly to the next one without making any noises. Like, the movement from your hand and from your pick and so forth will make noise in the transition from note to note, regardless of if there's a real slide happening. That's why I like to play some of the notes leading up to the actual note you're gonna play palm muted. Even though you're not really playing a palm mute, because this is way too quick, this is basically going to pretend like you're making that little slide sound, that little movement and so forth. And if you check that out right here, let me play it again. This is actually where it's extra obvious. It's like, those little subtle differences aren't super obvious when in the mix, but when you do it consistently throughout a song, wherever it matters, that is what's gonna really sell that effect. Now, whenever there's no such transition, like for example here, I did want to add a little bit more of that kind of noise, so I add another palm muted note just randomly somewhere down there, ideally still in the same key, just in case the noise does cut through a little bit. And so that way you see it like here, you see me do it right here. But that is really what's going to sell that effect. On these slower melodies, that's not really that big of a deal. But you'll see on the faster melodies, and we'll get there very soon, all those transitions, it's what's really selling the effect. Now, one final thing I did was adding some pitch bend. As you can see right here, we're at pitch bend. And basically, at the end of the slower nodes, I go up a little bit and down a little bit, just adding that little like pow, wow, wow, that a guitarist would usually do with their left hand, but never at the exact start of the note, because you still want to register, oh, this is the note, and then add the vibrato. That's usually how guitarists are gonna do it. So check this out again. So So just those little bends at the end can really sell the effect. However, now let's get into the most interesting part of this whole tutorial, in my opinion, and that is the solo overall. So yeah, this looks crazy. First of all, we have the fast run right here. What I did was I made all the actual beats harder picking. So as you can see, it's like hard, softer, softer, hard, softer, softer, hard. It's always on the 8 beat right here. So this is the first, second 8, the middle basically, and so forth. And then if we go down here, you notice that I added the tapping key switch, which is A sharp minus 1, and I made them soften all of those softer picked notes even more. The tapping key switch will essentially destroy the attack of your note. And that's what's going to sell some realism, because whenever you are picking extremely fast, especially on runs like this, you no longer have the same strength as if you were picking like a normal note or a stronger chord or something like that. So kind of removing that pick attack on all the weaker notes while still keeping the accents on every 8 beat really sells you doing that run. Now, little spoiler alert, after doing that run, we go into a completely different type of run, and we then employed a very different type of technique in terms of humanization. So right here, you have all of those notes, and if you were to grab this solo from, let's say, some guitar pro tab you made, you would just have this note, this note, this note, this note, this note, without all of those blue little mutes between them. But those blue little mutes between them is actually selling the effect. Once again, like I explained earlier, these aren't actual slides. If you were to actually play this lead on a normal guitar, you would notice a lot of that is on different strings and so forth, but you are adding all of those little movements between the notes that you would have when you're actually playing. It's those crunchy little mid-tones cutting between every note that's really gonna sell that this is a real player playing it. So let me show you right here. And that is a solo. It's simple as that. You're placing all of those little note transitions at whichever strength you think is correct. Might also want to employ the tapping key switch here and there. That's all up to you. Depends on experimentation and so forth. But as you can see right here, let me quickly solo this. These little movements is what's gonna sell it. Then finally, we have this outro right here, where once again, we're just going to have machine gunning palm mutes. We can check that out right here. So right here you see me employ another little trick, and that's whenever you do a chord and you want to mimic it being muted, you know, some actual silence, rather than just ending the note right there, it can be smart to add a little bit of a palm mute right here at the very end. It will mimic the sound of your left hand or right hand basically muting the string. There will still be some note information there, it will just no longer be a full sound. You heard that? It's bum. And of course, you add it to a whole mix. That sound will mostly drown, but once again, adding those little human touches here and there, even though it will mostly drown, will often still sell the whole thing much better. Next, we have low-key bass doing its magic. God, low-key is really our most popular bass. It really works well for deathcore like this, where everything is so busy that you don't just want a low-end smooth bass. You kind of sometimes still want that really aggressive mid in there to really blend with that guitar and make it this giant wall of sound. Just like on the Slaughter to Prevail tutorial I showed you the other day, I once again did zero humanization. I mean, this is deathcore. This bass is just gonna sit there, be aggressive, be hard. And if we want to have a more quiet moment, we just have no sound instead, like here. That is what's gonna make that contrast in a song like this rather than weaker playing. You can see the same right here. Whispers are glowing. These deathcore songs are usually just going to use silence to make contrast rather than, oh, I'll play at, you know, 50 velocity here or something like that. Same thing once again right here. Everything is gone. Just lo-fi, solo, no rhythm, no bass. But beyond that, the bass is all 127 velocity. Gotta keep the meme alive, right? Mjolnir, Lucas end up doing all the humanization. But interestingly, even after humanizing, for example, on Mjolnir drums, we still added one shots, which are hyper consistent just in the face drums. And I think you'll notice when you listen to Lorna Shore, Austin Archie is an insanely powerful drummer. Aggressive hits, controlled, consistent. So sure, our drums might be, you know, hella consistent in here, but Austin plays super consistent. So it's not the end of the world. Then for vocals, this is just three layers. If you want to see the actual specifics, I made an editing screams with Lorna Shore tutorial where I already showed you what kind of editing I did. I then baked those same beast presets you saw in that tutorial into these vocals and then sent them off like that. So what you hear right here is beast and then, you know, compression EQ, all of the good stuff. But I basically don't want to release any vocals without beast on them. It just sounds so much more interesting. But then, of course, you always have to put your screams into a mix to make it sound, you know, really sick. In terms of choirs, this is just the Logic stock choir. And I'm gonna be honest, the one thing that could be better about this whole production is just the choirs. Maybe one day Solemn Tones should hit up a choir and, you know, make our own choir sampler. I didn't do any humanization to the choir. It just needs to be there and be part of the mix. Kind of add that epic orchestral element. Kind of all almost like Nightwish, but then Lorna Shore style. As you can hear, not very realistic, but it's tucked under the mix, so it doesn't really matter that much. And then, of course, you have the strings at the same time here in the chorus. And then afterwards, we have the orchestral burr coming in the post-chorus. But once again, that burr is really low into the mix in the final production. Then we have Bifrost, just the cinematic effects, you know, all the risers, all the whooshes, all the bells and so forth. And then the one shots we already spoke of. So in the end, while Lorna Shore songs are definitely complex and a lot is going on, once you start condensing it down, it is quite manageable. And I was kind of surprised by that. Of course, when you put all of the buses together for the vocals and Bifrost and one shots and so forth, it will probably, you know, look a bit easier than it really is. But in the end, it's not the end of the world. I think if you have solid MIDI virtual instruments, get them at solemntones.com, of course, then it's pretty doable to program just full MIDI productions like that. So that is all. I hope you found this very interesting. If you wish to pick up your own Solemn Tones virtual instruments, you can do so at the link in the description or solemntones.com.